This screencast will focus on utilizing the Heaviside method as a methodology to solve differential equations using Laplace transforms. The Heaviside method is a very nice alternative for using partial fractions. Why? Because when using partial fractions, things can get a little mathematically messy by doing factoring, finding least common factors, etc., which can lead to potential errors in algebra. The Heaviside method is a more user-friendly way to find the values of the numerators that are typically seen in partial fractions, which can then be inverse Laplace transformed to obtain your answer in the time domain. Shown on the screen are the three equations that are used for the Heaviside method. There are three possibilities. First, the root that you have is not repeated, so it is by itself. In that case, you use the first equation, where r of k represents the value of the root, where r of k is present both as the limit, shown here, and is present in the first term. The next equation is used for situations where it is a repeated root, and it is the highest order present in the equation. So, for example, if you had a denominator of s minus 2 squared, you would use this second equation for the s minus 2 squared numerator. For the s minus 2 numerator, you would use the third equation, which is used for repeated roots where the order is not the maximum order. To show how the Heaviside method works for all three of these equations, we will use the formulas to solve the following equation, which is already in the Laplace domain. This equation here is an example of a repeated root because s squared plus 4s plus 4 can be factored into s plus 2 squared. So the first step of the Heaviside method is very similar to partial fractions, where we separate them all based on the root. So here we'll have a over s plus b over s plus 2 plus c over s plus 2 squared. So if we were to look at these, to find a, we're going to be s is not a repeated root. So therefore, we're going to use the first equation for that. B is a repeated root, but it is not the highest order. Therefore, in order to solve b, we will use the third equation. And finally, for c, we have s plus 2 squared. We have the repeated root and the one that corresponds to the highest order. So therefore, we will solve for c using the second equation. First, we will solve for a. The equation that we use to solve for a has been reproduced on the screen. Here, even though it is just s, the root here is implicitly 0. So therefore, in this case, r of k for both cases here equals 0. So a will equal the limit as s approaches 0 of s minus rk, which since it's 0 here, that will just be s, multiplied by y of s, which is s plus 1 over s times s plus 2 squared. What you'll notice is, and this will always happen when using the Heaviside method, is that the s minus rk term will always cancel out with a denominator with y of s, which makes sense because that the denominator of y of s has all of the roots. So in this case, the s in the numerator will cancel out with the s in the denominator. So what we now do is evaluate the limit. So when we evaluate the limit, this will just become 0 plus 1, since we're evaluating it as s approaches 0, divided by 0 plus 2 squared. And this easily gets us our value for a, which is 1/4. Note here that we very easily find the root without having to do any significant factoring out of terms, which happens when you try to find a least common denominator using partial fractions. Now, we will solve for c. C, if you recall, corresponded to the second equation, which represented the term which goes with the repeated root of highest order. So here, r of k, note the functional form here, it's s minus r of k, and we have in c, s plus 2. So therefore, for both of our cases here, r of k will equal negative 2. So now to solve for c, we just substitute in. So we'll have c equals the limit as s approaches negative 2 of s minus negative 2. So that's just s plus 2 squared multiplied by y of s. Once again, you will see cancellation with the S minus RK term and the S plus 2 term. And as a note here, the M term here corresponded to 2 because that represents the highest order of the equation. So when we evaluate what's left at negative 2, we end up with a half, and that is the value of C. Finally, we will solve for B using the third equation. And the third equation introduces a new variable, K, which is basically a counter variable that represents how close to the maximum order you are. As with the second equation, R of K is still going to be negative 2 here, and M will represent the highest order, which will be 2. K here, as noted earlier, represents a counter, but the counter here starts at 2, not 1. So therefore, for a first order repeated root, here the value of K is going to be 2, not 1, because of the fact that our counter here starts at 2 and goes up to M, which in this case, 2 is M, the order of the repeated root. So by taking all this information, we can solve for B. So B will be the limit as S approaches negative 2 of 1 over 2 minus 1 factorial multiplied by the derivative raised to the K minus 1 power multiplied by S minus RK, which here is S plus 2, raised to the maximum order, which we have, which is 2, multiplied by our Y of S. We can make some simplifications here. The S plus 2 squared terms cancel out. The 1 over 2 minus 1 factorial becomes 1 because it's 1 over 1 factorial. And the D2 minus 1, DS2 minus 1 becomes the first derivative. So now what we're left with is the limit as S approaches negative 2 of the first derivative of S plus 1 over S. So by using the quotient rule, we can obtain the fact that the derivative here is equal to 1 over s minus s plus 1 over s squared. We can now evaluate this limit to find the value of b. And that leaves us with our final answer for b, which is negative a quarter. Now that we have found all the values of our numerators, we can now begin to move along the process of solving for y in the time domain by taking advantage of the inverse Laplace transform. So what that leaves us with is our system in the Laplace domain is 1 quarter over s minus 1 quarter over s plus 2 plus 1 half over s plus 2 squared. So we take the inverse Laplace transform of 1 quarter over s. That is just the generic step function, which corresponds to a constant of 1/4. The second term is just a simple exponential, if you look at your Laplace transform sheet, where the exponential is raised to the negative power of the root here. Therefore, that'll be 2, because of the fact that it is in the S plus B domain in your Laplace transform sheet. So this becomes e to the negative 2t. We keep the constant floats out, so we keep the constant. Taking the inverse Laplace transform of the final term is a little trickier, but there is a corresponding Laplace transform in a Laplace transform sheet. So this is of the form 1 over s plus b raised to the n, and the inverse Laplace transform of this is t raised to the n minus 1 multiplied by e to the negative bt divided by n minus 1 factorial. B here represents the value inside the parenthesis, so since it's of the form s plus b, that would mean the fact that the value of b here is 2, and n represents the order of the exponent. In this case here, n is going to be 2. So when we substitute 2, these values of b and n, into our equation, we end up with t raised to the n minus 1, or t to the 2 minus 1, which is t. We have e to the negative bt, here b is 2, and we have n minus 1 factorial. 2 minus 1 factorial is 1 factorial, which is 1. We don't forget to bring back the 1 half constant that was present in the system to begin with, and we're done. We have determined the value of y as a function of time. So from this screencast, you have hopefully seen the great utility of the Heaviside method in lieu of partial fractions, particularly with respect to systems which don't have repeated roots. For systems with repeated roots, it comes generally down to more personal preference of whether or not you're more willing to take a derivative versus doing more factoring associated partial fractions. The Heaviside method is not exactly useful in the case that you have imaginary roots because of evaluating these limits as it goes to I. It is possible, but not necessarily recommended.